when we review subdivisions, what we, our conditions and what we do are reviewed prior to the actual subdivision of the land. How this would be a difficult situation to make work. Any, has anybody thought about that yet?
The, yeah, I guess the expectation we would have is how we've dealt with the provision of performance guarantees before the sale of lots and phases is we put a very prominent note on the recording plat, and the expectation would be that if someone were to purchase the property, they would probably have to get a bank loan, and hopefully a title attorney or someone would pick that note up prior to the actual transfer of deeds.
Okay. Okay. So the fact that it's on the plan makes it something that gets dealt with. Yes, Dave?
I'd like to just get one clarification. What you're proposing is that you would break the total parcel up into areas so that if the likelihood of one of the lots sold, it would only trigger that area. Can you define all those areas?
Yes, the way that it's written in the condition is that it refers to the major lots. We are currently, this property is subject to a prior subdivision, and we are amending the 10 lots in that current subdivision. That's what we're doing here. So we are referring to those 10 original lots. And they're all still part of this amended plan. So, for example, this is all lot one here, okay, all over here. So if there are any houses over here that are sold, then the review would be on lot one. This is lot two. This is lot 10. Okay. They're all...
I understand.
Thank you. Moving on at this point, I guess we have another item to review, which would be how performance guarantees are put in place during the course of the build-out of the subdivision, if you will.
As you know from our submission of January 4th, we are asking for a waiver of the performance guarantee standard. I don't want to get too much into what Seth has already talked about already, but we are asking for a waiver of the performance guarantee standard until the time that the first lot, wherever that may be, was to be built upon. And to reiterate what we said already, we don't know where that first lot would be, we don't know what the first phase would be, and in the keeping of the whole spirit of the development of the Sprague Estate or non-development of the Sprague Estate, we don't want to promote any unnecessary physical activity out there. We don't want to commit to building this right here or this right here if indeed the first phase might be Ice Pond Road, one of the lots off of that. So there is a certain practical consideration in asking for this waiver of the performance guarantee. This, of course, is in keeping with the long-term management style of the Sprague Corporation, not to go in there and turn loose the bulldozers and the cutters to do the work that's necessary. Of course, we wanted just to maintain the property as much as possible. That's been the theme all along. We've talked at length about the special nature of this property. I know that Maureen, in her cover letter of January 19th, goes to great length to talk about the whys and the wherefores for most traditional subdivisions. While it's necessary to have a performance guarantee for all those obvious reasons, in case the roads weren't to be built, in case people had to have some guarantees that the road would be completed. It's a measure of protecting the general public. Of course, this is not the case right here. The public, as Seth has pointed out, cannot buy the land, cannot buy the lots. There really is no member of the public that we're trying to protect here by a performance guarantee. Secondly, again, as Maureen points out in her memo, that if a performance guarantee were pulled on a traditional subdivision, the town would have the ability to go in and finish off the public improvements, to complete the road, to put the water line in. The public, as my understanding, does not even have the right now to go on to this private property. It's our understanding that the town would not have the right or the ability to enter onto or to complete the improvements that are talked about. Thirdly, that the road would have to be done, of course, prior to getting an occupancy permit. So there are a number of safeguards, we feel, that are in place already. We, of course, are willing to obtain a performance guarantee, when necessary. We've talked about this already. When it is, it may be next year, it may be the springtime, it may not be 20 years from now. We just don't know. Does the planning board have the authority to waive this regulation? Well, we believe that it does. If you look on page 15 in the subdivision ordinance, we pointed this out in our cover letter. The planning board, this is item number 6, the planning board shall set the amount, terms, and conditions of a performance guarantee to secure completion of all required public improvements. Again, the term public improvements. These are all private improvements. And we're asking that the amounts, terms, and conditions, well, the condition be that we allow the Spray Corporation to post the performance bond and guarantee at the time when it's necessary, and not to encourage any unnecessary construction out here before it's time. What does the town have to say about granting waivers? Again, going to the ordinance on page 34, section 16.3.5. If a waiver is granted, there are four conditions that have to be met. The first has to do with traffic and sewage. The second has to do with varied imaginative subdivision design. The third one says that granting the waiver will secure substantially the standards of road design and construction required by this chapter in the zoning ordinance. We are agreeing to build the roads according to the design criteria that the town engineers has placed on the property and the planning board we hope will agree upon. So they will be built according to those 78 pages of drawings at the time when they're necessary. And maybe more importantly, under the waiver provision, you have to determine that granting the waiver will not have the effect of nullifying the intent and objectives of the comprehensive plan or this chapter. Again, the intent and comprehensive plan, we feel, is to maintain the character of the property, not to encourage development, not to encourage taking down trees before their time. While we understand that the board has the authority to grant the waiver, we feel that here's a situation where it certainly is in the best interest not only of the Spray Corporation but certainly of the town to allow this to happen at a pace that's consistent with the objectives of the implementation of the plan. And lastly, the other related element to this is a section that we ask about and are requesting in our application letter. We would like to be able to do some elements of the work, be it upgrading the road, replacing culverts, at a time that other parts of the property are being improved, be it for annual maintenance or perhaps for improvements to some of the roadway, without coming and asking for a specific performance guarantee for that element. This, again, is an unusual request, but I think that's very much in keeping with the style of operation that John and the Spray Corporation have exhibited over the past. When they see things that need to be done, do it then, to maintain the flexibility to do the work as-needed basis or as required. There are some elements, and we're not talking about doing major portions of the road improvements, but we're talking about some elements. We don't know at this point exactly where this may occur, where it may just be replacing a culvert or increasing the radius in a corner or extending a very short segment of a gravel road and widening it slightly, that we feel that it would be in all of our interest to allow that sort of minimal amount of work to occur without the formality of going back to the town and going through the whole performance guarantee routine. We realize that the Sprague Corporation is at risk, that at some point the town engineer, if a lot that is improved that way, if the road was improved that way, is going to have to be proven that the gravel was put in properly, that the road is wide enough. However, that's been the pattern all along. We only have to look at the Monastery Road, which we've all used as the model of how we expect roads to be built out here, as a good example of a road that was built without benefit of the town engineer going out and inspecting the entire length of it. We only have to look at examples like that to know that the Sprague Corporation certainly knows how to build good roads well suited to this type of environment. So that's our impressions on where we're at with performance guarantee. We certainly love to answer any questions relative to that.
Any questions from board members? Terry, could you specifically address a procedure for fire ponds, since they appear to be out of sync with the rest of phasing? And they're definitely part of the waivers package from the board's perspective. They may be done out of sequence. They may be done out without regard to the other phase, any
right.
other
yeah,
phase.
They're done roughly on a yearly basis starting this very year.
How does that process work? Does the fire chief work with you on that? I mean, would we be able to, would there be documentation of that?
Yeah, so, well, included in the plan, we will put, in fact, as we discussed on page, I think, 4, the years that those improvements will occur. To tie it into a performance guarantee, I believe, to post a guarantee is $1,000. To build the improvement is $900 on most of these ponds. So we really do not want to tie a guarantee to the improvement. We, in fact, could easily spend that $1,000 improving the pond that year. So we'd like to keep that separate on the 7-year schedule, in fact, including Pond 1 this year. So we do not want to tie the performance guarantee, but we will, in fact, be providing on the overview fire protection plan additional information as to when, what year those improvements will occur. And, in fact, on some of lot 6, for example, even in our phasing plan, prior to that permit being pulled, that pond would have to be built. No matter where it fits in our 7-year schedule. So we've tried to address that issue. If the pond is required for that cluster, then it will have to go in prior to those lots having a permit pulled. We've tried to address all those issues, but we just do not want to, we don't see it fit to tie it to a performance guarantee specifically.
But as such, when a pond is improved, is it done at the direction of the fire chief?
Absolutely. We are using all of the specs of the fire chief. We're in fact working with the assistant chief. He put in the previous dry hydrants. We're using the design and working with the chief to put in the second set of improvements for these hydrants. So we have no knowledge of how to do this. We're relying on the fire chief to help us with this. So it's just an ongoing dialogue using his information, and he will be on site as we do this. If there needs to be a note to that effect, that's fine as well.
Well, I was just thinking, at some point in time, if there are enough improvements that require the posting of a performance guarantee, roads are going to be built or whatever, and they're in an area that a fire pond would be servicing, there would need to be a record at that point in time of the fire pond being built to the chief's standards. Otherwise, we would need a performance guarantee on the building of the pond itself and those improvements. I would imagine there would need to be some type of way for that to become part of a phase when it was finally built, because it's related to what gets built in terms of providing fire service.
I guess it's my understanding the fire ponds are really reviewed and inspected by the fire chief. not the town engineer.
Right.
Subtle, but I think important difference.
Right, that's what I'm saying. But that is, so that is documented and flow tested and whatnot as they're done.
Pipe sizes and the gravel bottoms and the slopes and so forth are all done to his specifications. In fact, it's my understanding he's already been out and inspected a couple of conversions already.
Okay.
Right, in fact, all of the ponds on the property all were put in with the oversight of the chief. And we fully expect that will happen with this next go-round.
Yes, Nancy.
As I recall, we suggested, and you agreed, that some of the houses would have fire sprinklers, had to have sprinklers. Those were already existing houses, but what about these lots? Are we going to need more of the sprinklers as we go along developing the lots?
Actually, not only the existing structures, there were a few of those, but also all the new lots. All the lots, new lots included, that would require a sprinkler system are identified on the plan.
Okay.
And we have an overview plan in the package that is the fire protection overview plan that includes the cross-hatching, I believe, of all those lots, and I'll let you read that.
That's on lot, on page 4 in your, okay, in your diagram.
So I'll remember that and look at it when I go.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Al.
A question for Maureen on her memorandum, referring specifically to page 3, first paragraph. Town requires a performance guarantee. And down to the last sentence there. In order to avoid the situation where partially completed work must be completed at the town's expense, no sale of lots within a subdivision or alteration of the site is permitted without a performance guarantee. But in this case, we're not having any sale. It's going to be held by the Sprague Corporation who only leased. Seems to me that we could add that language to the proposal that you have at the bottom of the same page. The planning board is waived, and then you get down the board, and in the event of a sale of a lot, the planning board shall review the entire subdivision, and we can add to that, and require a performance bond.
That's certainly one way to go, but the second half of the sentence also mentions or alteration of the site. So the idea is that you would not allow an applicant to start clearing for a road, start digging a trench without erosion control, start making promises without having a financial guarantee in place to guarantee that the plan approved by the planning board is actually what gets constructed.
Ball's in your court. As I understand it, at that point, then, that will trigger this letter of credit that you're talking about if you get into any one of these phases.
Once, yes. Once someone goes to pull the first building permit, we're saying that we'll be gladly come with our performance guarantee or letter of credit.
At that time. I think that would be.
Didn't you ask for a waiver of performance guarantees? You do understand that there's a question that the subdivision approval will expire in 3 years if you don't pull some kind of guarantee. That's the opinion of our attorney right now.
I guess we're getting right down to the nibs here. This is a plan that we're proposing for future for the future of our property, and we didn't expect that when we came to the town to involve you in a process that we've been developing over a number of years, develop a family plan and bring it in so that it was also part of a town plan, and that we were working together to create a plan for what would happen in the future, that as a consequence of us coming forward with a plan for the future, that, oh, it's not a plan for the future, you have to do it now. That's not what we were contemplating, and we really don't want to be put into the position of of having our willingness to come forward and get involved in this process result in us having to start immediately.
Can I ask a question? Other than who turned the heat so high in here? Okay, you're saying that if they don't pull a poster performance guarantee within 3 years, they're in danger of losing their approval. Now, the question is, can they go post a very small performance guarantee for doing some minimal road work, satisfy it, and then preserve their approvals for eternity?
That's what the applicant, myself, met in the manager's office with the town attorney, and that is the scenario that I have recommended, that they define a phase one, that phase one be an amount of work that is acceptable to the planning board and to the applicant, that they do phase one. They post a guarantee for phase one, and they build and complete phase one. And thereafter, their approval remains valid until such time as they decide to alter it. There's nothing in the subdivision ordinance that says that upon completion of phase one, you must immediately begin phase two and phase three. What town staff are recommending is that we have several people, several families living at the end of a dead-end road that has marginal access through two roads. And what our recommendation was to take those improvements, those minimal improvements to the loop road that will guarantee access from two different points, and call that phase one, have the applicant improve the roads per their plans. And I truly believe that those are improvements that should be done now in order to safeguard the people who live down there at this time, and that any additional phases would only be initiated by the applicant as they pull building permits. And that's another reason why the phasing plan is so critical.
We're happily living within the bounds of the existing subdivision plan that's been approved by the town. We've come forward with a proposal for how that could be amended. The whole thing is based upon that point at which we are going to change the use of the land. And that's when somebody requires a new home. At that point, we're on to our amendment. That's as simple as it is. Now, we don't want to be put into the position of having come forward with this plan, having to change our existing way that we're enjoying the use of our property.
Have you had an attorney review that issue of either file within 3 years or lose the possibility under the current code? Has anyone looked at that point?
We haven't had our attorney look at it. Right.
I mean, Maureen's position is that the town attorney has looked at this, and you would stand in jeopardy of this whole thing after we gave you the approval and supposedly a waiver on this issue is what you're asking for. But you might lose the whole thing in 3 years, assuming that there had been no development and lots had been pulled or anything of that sort. So I think it's an extremely dangerous position if you might be doing so.
Well, it's also a frustrating one for us to have come this far, and the whole premise that we came forward to the town with 2 years ago is being thrown back in our face, and we're being told that we have to start, widening the roads now. Now, if this is what we have to do, we're prepared to do it. Frankly, we're hoping that we don't have to do that, and I'm simply going to have to, depend on the planning board. And if you feel that you can't give us assurances that our approval that we're going to receive is going to be good, unless we start a phase one now, I guess we'd have to come up with a phase one now.
The ordinance talks about action upon approval. I think that's the issue right here. This is on page 16 of the subdivision ordinance. And it says that upon signature of the majority of the planning board, the plans have to be recorded in the registry of deeds. Any plans not so recorded within 90 days shall become null and void. It doesn't make any reference to starting the activity or completion, but once they're started, then we have 3 years to complete.
Well, Terry, there are other aspects of state zoning law that may pertain to the act of subdividing land that aren't in our statutes as a town that may still pertain to this project. Have you thought of an alternate phase one that you, or, because if there are laws like that that in effect vacate subdivisions that never happen, there's probably a good reason for that.
Absolutely. On page 10, I'll make two brief comments. If the board determines, this is page 10 of the subdivision ordinance number 8, if the board determines that security for performance is required for the completion of any proposed site improvements, the procedures and standards of section 16.2.4 shall apply. So there's another opportunity beside a waiver where there is saying if the board determines that. Secondly, I think if there's an opportunity that could exist between now and perhaps the next meeting where we have an opportunity to be granted that waiver, we would ask that the board allow us that opportunity. We would be happy then if it is an absolute given that we cannot get that waiver, we'd be happy to come in with a phase one, so to speak. But we'd like to at least indulge the board to allow us, you know, if it is possible, we'd like to see the waiver. And if it is absolutely not possible, we can come in with a portion of a phase to call phase one.
One more question, following up my last question. Can they designate anything they want as phase one?
All phasing must be approved by the planning board. So no, they cannot designate anything they want. They have to show you a phase, and you have to review it and approve it per the phasing plan standards.
Well, you already had a list of things that you would like the loops and things of that sort.
Well, you know, I've discussed this with the applicant for some time, and clearly they don't like the suggestion. I think at this point they're looking for some guidance from the planning board. Is that correct?
That's correct. I'll make one comment regarding the loop. Let's take a Ram Island Farm Road, for example. It runs through a beautiful portion of the property. You know, if in fact there's no need to be improving something in the middle of lawn just for the sake of making a road, I don't see that that's necessary. I think we can pick something, if it is absolutely necessary, that would allow that loop to be better served by the emergency vehicles without perhaps doing the whole loop.
I can't speak for the panel, but I have no objection to a waiver from the clear understanding that as each development is triggered, that obviously the work is done and the performance guarantee comes in. But I think in light of Maureen's concerns, you would be well advised to run that past your own attorney.
On reflection, I think that's a good idea. And maybe we can do that and then either proceed along the line that we're hoping to, or maybe have to regroup and find another approach.
Good.
Is that generally an agreeable plan on this item?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Mr. Wilcox, is the motion appropriate at this time?
Does the applicant have any further issues to raise for us at this point? It's not too late.
Do you have any outstanding issues for us?
I think at this point we've covered outstanding issues on the table.
With your permission, Mr. Wilcox, I have a motion.
Yes.
Motion for the board to consider, be it audited based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Sperry Corporation for final subdivision review, a resource protection permit, and four private accessway permits for a 62-lot subdivision located south of the Bowery Beach Road be tabled to the regular February 16th, 1999 meeting of the planning board with the consent of the applicant.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
We need to ask for the consent of the applicant.
Do we have your consent to table this and see you next month? Thank you. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you very much. We'll look forward to further developments. So to speak.
It's warm. I don't even have a sweater on. Oh, I think it's unusual for this to be, shouldn't there be something we can turn down?
Maureen, I didn't turn it down to 59.
No control. I've never been this warm.
We have one final item. Oh, no, we have two final items on the evening's agenda. Moving to new business. We have the Tinsman Retail Building Addition, a request by Thomas Tinsman for site plan review of a proposed addition to the ERA Real Estate Office located at 349 Ocean House Road, and to be reviewed under Section 19-9, Site Plan Completeness. If the applicant could come to the podium, give us a brief overview of the project, and perhaps describe the completeness of the application, we'll then look at that issue first.
My name is Tom Tinsman. I'm the owner of the property at 349 Ocean House Road. My proposal tonight is to construct an addition to my existing building. We'll be doing it in one phase, and hopefully. And basically, you have all the material in front of you, so if you have any questions, be happy to answer them.
Mr. Parker.
What has changed since this one? I'm getting too hot. What has changed with the formal application since we saw this in workshop? Plans just been cleaned up, or? And have there been any changes? I guess I'm finding some high points here.
I think the only major change, Steve, is the, originally, I had hoped to be able to put an entrance from my parking lot onto the school access road. And I have subsequently met with the school board, and they did not like the idea, so we scrapped that idea. Other than that,
that answered my second question. That answered my second question. I was surprised that there was any agreement at all from the town to allow you to do that. It just seemed uncharacteristic of them to do that. But since they said no, I guess that sort of answers that question.
It must be hot in here. I thought I had a letter in the package that said just the opposite from the town manager.
dated much earlier, however.
Yeah, that was dated quite some time ago, and that was prior to my meeting with the school board.
I thought this was town property, not school department property.
You thought it was what?
Well, the town manager just told us that the jurisdiction of all this property lies with the town, not with the school board.
Well, as I think he indicated on the other, the pool project, was that the town owns the property, but they go on recommendations and suggestions of the school board. And when I talked to Mike McGovern about the access to the school road, he had set up the meeting for me to go to the school board, and when I did, they didn't like the idea.
All right.
Yes, Tom.
The real issue here initially is completeness, is it not?
Yes.
Should we just go through the planner's memo and see where we end up?
Okay.
I would like to do that if possible.
All right, then.
Because it's so easy to get off into discussions about the substantive review rather than the issue of completeness.
Perhaps some explanation of items which have been flagged as pending. Might be appropriate rather than going through the entire list, since most of them have yes.
Yeah, okay.
As they're in the application.
I'm assuming you want me to do this?
Please.
Okay. I just wanted to note that the town engineer just dug right into this project, and his comments reflect completeness and substantive comments. So if you can kind of read his letter and think about the items that are missing first, and then the rest of the items are provided for the applicant's benefit, but don't really need to be addressed until we've made a determination of completeness. But going down through the site plan completeness checklist, the checklist is in is page 3 of the memo you have in front of you. And what I've done is I've put a Y for things that I thought were complete, a no for things that I thought were not complete, and a P for things that are partially complete or partially incomplete. Starting with item 6. Proposed buildings. There is an existing shed on the site, and the applicant's proposing a new parking lot there, but hadn't specified what was going to happen to the shed, whether it's going to be demolished or moved. So that information was missing. Under item 10, parking, loading, and unloading areas. Typically, what we ask is that the applicant will at least dimension off one of the spaces so that we can see that parking spaces meet our minimum parking space size. Also, that they distinguish between compact spaces and regular spaces. Further, that the width of the parking aisles also be dimensioned off so we can determine that those meet the plans. The town engineer has also noted several specific details of things that would be needed to assure that the parking lot is constructed and doesn't fall apart. Under number 11, the town engineer's comments, there's curbing proposed, and he's asking that the plans more clearly show exactly where the curbing is supposed to be located, details regarding the concrete sidewalk and how it's going to be constructed, and if ramps are going to be provided. If you have curbing and concrete and a walkway, you've got to have a place where the curbing drops off, and there's a ramp that gets from the grade of the parking lot to the grade of the sidewalk. On 12A, there's been a lot of discussion about stormwater, and the applicant has talked to the Public Works Director and got permission to connect to an existing storm drain. However, there are still some details missing on how that connection is going to be made, and the town engineer is suggesting that we should get some calculations so we know how much water is being created and draining into this facility. 12C, the applicant has noted that they're expecting letters on utilities, specifically water and sewer. We have not yet received those letters. The only reason this becomes particularly important is that several years ago, this same building was before the planning board, and I believe at that time it was determined that the existing water service line was 3/4 inch, which seems kind of small for the proposed uses. Perhaps the water line size has increased since then or needs to be increased, but that's why that information is particularly needed for this particular issue. And finally, under item 13, there are many existing trees on the site, and the applicant is proposing to maintain, preserve all of those trees, which is consistent with what the board likes to see. However, there needs to be some kind of a preservation plan that talks about how these trees are actually going to survive through the construction phase. So those are the items that staff has suggested might potentially be incomplete. Are there any questions?
Yes, Tom?
I'd like to make a motion.
Please do.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Tom Tinsman for site plan review of a proposed retail building adjacent to existing building located at, is that 349?
Yes.
349 Ocean House Road be deemed complete with the following comments added, that all comments of the town engineer's report be incorporated in the plan, and that the site plan be prepared. Let me describe the situation, then we can determine what the language should be. The applicant indicates in the literature that the that Sebago Technics or a consultant is engaged in doing site planning or site engineering. I've seen certain pieces of information on the site plan that don't seem to be consistent with that, some of the grading in the parking lot and some other things. So I'm, for the purposes of getting this project moving forward and under discussion, I'm willing to accept the material as complete, but I want to alert the applicant that that doesn't mean that I'm not going to ask for considerably more information or, let's put it that way, clearer drawing, site plan drawings.
What about the incomplete? Lorraine just mentioned in her list.
And the items that are included in the planner's list as partially complete be brought into completion with the next submittal.
Second that.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion regarding completeness? Yes, Tom.
Just a couple of general comments without getting into the substance of the plan. There's a lot going on a very small site, and I think in terms of getting the material more thorough, if complete isn't the right answer, I had a list of questions that I would like to see addressed under what I would probably be a completeness issue. One is that there's an existing building and a proposed building. There's several levels within the building. Is there an elevator in any of the buildings?
No.
Then I think as the purview of the planning board that it be very clearly understood where handicapped access is, and that we have letters, if not from the fire marshal's office, certainly from the code enforcement officer with respect to handicap compliance and requirements to certain either leasable areas or living areas. Because I believe there are at least three, if not four, levels in the proposed buildings and the existing buildings.
There'll be three.
Three.
Three levels.
As I said earlier, I think, and as the town engineer noted, that the property line description should be noted, and it appears as though the site plans have been prepared using what I would term as an older or a different software package than what a lot of design firms are using currently that really registers a more accurate level of information. And I don't know if that's available from the surveyor, but with regardless, I, in order to get all of this laid out, I mean, you've got parking extending from the very back of the curb down to a 15-foot setback line. That is, and the building is at the minimum setback in the front. There's no give in that tolerance, so I think that all of the dimensional layout information absolutely has to be there with bearings and all of the other information. There's inconsistencies in the elevations and the description that Mr. Nemesis provide in terms of, it appears in the elevations that the existing building is pretty much left as is, and yet the cover letter describes it as being reshingled with the new material. I just think that needs to be clearly depicted on the plans. I didn't see a dumpster location, if you've got mixed uses like residential, you've got coffee shop, that type of light food service, I think that should be very clearly understood. I don't know if you as the, if everyone just dumps everything into one dumpster, how that works, but that should be access to that, particularly where everything is so tight, I think is going to be crucial to the overall plan. And an understanding of the fire protection requirements when we get the letter from the Portland Water District as to whether or not you intend to, or are required to sprinkle at the building.
Any other comments regarding items of questions or on items of completeness? I have a question for the applicant regarding work along the boundary line to the school drive access. There's a sidewalk shown here. Is that an existing sidewalk or a new sidewalk?
There are no sidewalks there currently.
Is that a proposed sidewalk part of this application that's shown on the plan? Do you have an agreement with the town to do excavation, removal of material, and building the sidewalk there? Do you have some type of right title and interest to do work outside of your own property?
No.
Can you get that for us?
I don't know. I think I can.
I think you'll have to.
I think I will then.
Any other items?
Steve?
No. Yes, yes, Dave.
Mark, Chairman. Along those lines, question to Maureen. In the town comprehensive plan for sidewalks, I know you just finished your planning coming up Scott Dyer Road. Is there anything that would run it further down that might help Mr. Tinsman in his assessment of the sidewalk that he proposes here as far as the design that might make it, you know, consistent with what you have, it might help him in his efforts?
The town center plan calls him, and Mr. Tinsman was a member of the town center planning committee, so he was part of the decision to recommend that sidewalks be constructed on both sides of Route 77 throughout the town center. And the current town center sidewalk construction proposal stops just short of the shopping center. I spoke with Mr. Tinsman, and it's our expectation that what he's showing for sidewalk along Route 77 would be consistent with what would be constructed for sidewalk along the town center, the town construction of sidewalks, including the creation of an esplanade and street trees. In addition, portion of the sidewalk is actually on the Tinsman property. And he has agreed, I believe, to provide us with a public access easement so that, in fact, we are able to create a wider esplanade for trees and still create the public sidewalk that we want.
Yes.
Any other completeness items? Yes.
Is it, I don't want to get into substantive review. Is it appropriate just to indicate to the applicant further issues that one may see on the plans that could be part of the
I think with the applicant's consent, after we vote on completeness, no matter which way we vote on it, perhaps a little more discussion regarding direction or insights or further questions. I know it's getting late, but maybe a couple of minutes after that might be well spent.
After we vote on completion?
After we vote on completeness, yeah. I have couple other
things. Yeah, okay.
Any other discussion on completeness? We have a motion.
In a second.
And a second. Any further discussion on completeness? All those in favor of the motion, indicate by raising your right hand. We have a complete application. Now, in terms of discussion of further items, Are there any further items of clarification or issues you would like us to address at this point?
Well, maybe I could elaborate a little bit on the building itself.
Okay.
Since we don't have a floor plan with the building. It will be a 2.5-story building, similar to the building that is already on the property. And my hope is to provide space for businesses that, and services that we don't currently have in the town. I've had discussions with several different individuals for businesses that want to be housed in this building, and they will be services that we don't currently have in the town, other than the apartments on the third floor, which we currently do have, but the town center plan calls for more. We did send a letter to Maureen today to address some of the pending issues, and my architect, Bill Nemers, is here to answer some of the more technical questions that you might have on those items.
Thank you. Any other aspects of the plan that the board would like to discuss? Yes, Tom?
Just a couple of heads up, and I think they're probably included in the town engineer's comments to a certain extent. The grading along the north side of the building slopes from a high elevation of about 125 down toward a walkway that has a stairway in it. And it appears from the plan that all that water is going to sheet right across the walkway. You may have to capture that someplace. In the middle of the parking lot, there's fairly steep slopes. I scaled them at about 10%, which is twice what's normally either allowed or suggested in terms of if one opens a car door. Normally in the range of a 5% slope is what the slope that'll, through gravity, the door will slam back on your leg. And I think you have room to resolve that. I think there's some issues with the circulation within the parking lot. We have two dead-end bays, and particularly the back one. If the parking lot is filled and one gets to the back of the lot, then it really becomes a struggle. Either one of those spaces has to be dedicated as a turnaround space where someone can pull in to turn their car around. Continuous circulation back there might be preferable, but I can see what you're trying to do. You're trying to get as much parking given the building size.
What do you think about turnarounds in those areas, in those lanes, back into here so that cars can back into those, into the setback?
I'm not sure, to tell you the truth. Depends on what the dimensions are here, but that may be necessary. I think that's something that the, I'm not sure you can even do that within the 15-foot setback. I think you have to maintain 15-foot setback to pavement, so that probably wouldn't be allowed under the ordinance, but you can resolve that with Maureen. And I think it would be very helpful to have a floor, even a schematic floor plan. The elevations are very helpful, but to have a schematic floor plan so that we can understand what's going on in terms of the interior of the building and the outside access. It's not really clear to me how you have, I only see really one entrance to a building from the front. And my understanding is that all the living units are on the third floor. And again, that may be perfectly fine, but if there are other egress or handicapped accessible issues. In the elevation of the building, it appears as though the porch on the north side, or what you call the covered walk, is narrower in the elevation than it may be in the plan. Is that just an optical illusion, Bill, or is that? It looks narrower than 6 feet in the elevation, and in the plan, I think it scales at 6 feet or more on the site plan. 6 feet. My only other observation, and I apologize, I wasn't here for a workshop meeting when this was presented, is that at least as it's represented in the plans that we have, is that the elevation of the existing building isn't yet tied into the proposed building. But my understanding is, based on Bill's letter, is that that will happen, that the details and and the siding would all be done so that this looks like one, not necessarily the same structure, but unified.
Yes.
And I don't know if I saw anything in the sign is still here, the pylon sign.
Had to bring that up.
Yeah, we'll hold that in reserve. I just wanted to let you know that I saw it on the plan. But the intent now is that it stays. Is that not correct? My only vision was that it suddenly would get taller and there would be more and more names added to the top and it might have to get a little brighter. But I have the privilege of making light of this because I've been on the board so long and I recall how far back we started that discussion.
We've discussed this before, haven't we?
You probably could do a 20-story high-rise here. If the sign disappeared, nobody would realize that there were anything else going on with the site. So, being facetious, of course. I think my general comment is I think there's an awful lot going on with the site. I mean, it's packed in every square inch, and when you get down to the final site plan and really start dimensioning things out, things may have to give and take a little bit.
Yeah, one of my original intention, and we were able to stay with this intention, was to design a building and a use that all fit within the ordinance. Mm-hmm. So that we didn't ask for any variances for encroaching on sidelines, we didn't ask for any variances on parking, we didn't want to do any of that.
Yeah.
Having served on the Town Center Planning Committee, I learned a lot from that committee, and I really benefited from being on that committee, but some of the things that I gathered from that, we've tried to implement into this proposal to make it pedestrian-friendly and to provide services that the town, I believe, need, and to not go overboard and try to ask for more than what the ordinance allowed for.
Let me ask another question in relationship to that. In relation to that issue, that you have offered us a, I think, a very interesting table or summary of parking requirements by time of day, and I haven't looked into the materials thoroughly enough to understand. Are you implying by that table that you can't accommodate all the parking at all times, that you're using the shared parking concept in order to meet the total parking requirement for the structures?
I'd like to let Bill discuss that.
The answer is a qualified yes. We've got, if you look at the spaces, required at this point going by 8 spaces for the residential. You need so many spaces for the square footage allotment. It brings us to 54 some parking spaces required under the strict guidelines provided in the code. Of those 54, 8 of them are residential, which is we wanted to try to get some residential in there, and but we could double use some of the parking. So we took a look at all the parking requirements of the various users of the building as we're looking at for prospective tenants right now, and tried to put a value on these spaces where the heavy uses of them were, where the light uses were. More to prove to ourselves that we could get by with less those number of spaces. We have provided, shown here, 50 spaces, and I know this is can be argued in many different ways. I think we provided some explanation that we probably can maybe use 46 spaces or so would be reasonable based on if everything in that graph was taken as gospel. But I think what it told me is that we probably can relax that 54 spaces some, and so we provided 50 spaces. That's.
I just want to be sure that, without getting into the details of how you've calculated all this, be sure that if the weekend use is an issue, because what you've done here is you have daytime hours of operation, but you haven't divided from weekday to weekend. But if that's an issue, if for whatever reason, the donut shop or the, and I agree, I think there are uses here that aren't provided in town that will be beneficial to the town center. But just for your own benefit, so that you're not discouraging use of the facilities because you don't have adequate parking, that if there are weekend needs, just something that and again, I hate to get into this level of detail this early in the process, but for example, you have an existing office building and the hours of operation are 8 to 5. And I jokingly put down as either there's no principal at that office or there are no secretaries, because those are usually the official office hours, but it's very unusual not to have at least one or two people getting there much earlier and getting right. much and staying later. And I think the issue on the residential, I think, if this is, you know, working couples or working individuals and they're both off to work in the morning and the two cars are gone, then that probably averages out. But I think it may be too liberal of an interpretation to assume that more than one car is going to be absent from the lot at any time. That allows you to reduce the requirement by 50%. I think to go any further than that, I think, is too liberal interpretation. I enjoyed looking at this, and I think it's an interesting, very interesting diagram. I think it would be, as you come through with your final plans, to look at this very carefully. I've been involved in some recent office parking requirements where we're parking one per 200 or five per 1,000, and it's not enough, even though that's all the ordinance requires, because with movable office furniture now and with computers, you're able to get almost two people into a similar space that you might have had for one person in the past. So I think you really, not only do you have to meet the ordinance, but you just have to make a case that you have something here that's going to be going to suit your tenants' needs as well.
Yes, Nancy.
So you're going to have four housing units, and is that two rooms per unit? In the next thing over, area calculation, it says two per unit.
Two cars per unit are required.
And how big are the housing units going to be?
I think three of them are one bedroom, and one of them is two bedroom.
And is there a living area and a kitchen?
Right. But there are three of them are one-bedroom apartments, and one of them is a two-bedroom apartment.
So there are two rooms.
That's correct. Well, at least two. Yeah, living room and bedroom and a bathroom.
Plus a
closets and that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Kitchenette and a. And what about the office capacity?
The office capacity?
Yeah. Is there any office capacity?
Yes, there is a. We looked at a possibility of two tenants that we were really concerned ourselves with. I mean, that's a health club and a small restaurant, coffee shop, right at this time. There's space other than that in the building, and that would be the retail space, or I'm sorry, the office space. So it may be.
You're keeping it flexible.
That's correct.
But it could be one or two firms?
I'm sure it could, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes, Steve.
When you come back, did you have a landscape plan that is consistent or something? I mean, I'm looking from little circles of existing and little circles that are going to be planted, and if you go from one plan, the site plan, to the landscape plan, or to existing condition, if you look at the boundaries and with the trees, especially on the school driveway side, the trees aren't located on the same in the same area. They're close. But not, one half maybe on one side of the property line and 1% half on the other. I just find it confusing, and I think it's going to be kind of important because you do have some nice existing trees there. Which one's really going to be kept, which ones can't be, what is going to be planted, and really where they're going to be in relationship to the buildings. Yep. Okay.
Yes, Tom.
I apologize for coming back to this, but I had marked it on the plan, and I just want to be sure it's addressed. It appears, though, it's not an issue, but sight lines at the intersection, this high school intersection, I can drive by that as easily, and I only go in there a million times a year, but because that island is so far back, it's just, and you have the Pond Cove driveway, and I just want to be sure that I scale 30 feet back, and I don't know if that's the town ordinance requirement or not, from the corner property line, and the building wasn't encroaching that area, but I think it would be helpful. Maybe we have a site walk or whatever, but I think it'd be helpful to confirm that there are no sightline issues with respect. I saw the letter and the distances that were measured from the driveway, but I want to be sure there are no sightline issues coming out of the high school driveway as well that might be affected by the building move closer to the road, which admittedly the ordinance likes you to do.
It requires us to do. There's another item that probably can go along, and that is that there's an awful lot of trees on that corner right now, and to what extent they might...
I don't disagree.
We probably should take a look at that just to see whether it'd be in the best interest of... I mean, we'd like to save the trees, but whether or not it's in the best interest to do something.
Any other comments? There were a couple of things that I noticed that perhaps you could just take a look at in the intervening time. The plan, the footprint appears to be about 104 feet long, and that would be something that could be confirmed with the floor plan of the building regarding the 100-foot footprint maximum dimension in the town center zone. And another item I noticed regarding grading is the handicapped spaces do not have ADA cross grade requirements taken into account. You might take a look at that. They need to be fairly flat. ADA has a 2% maximum in any direction.
For what?
For the grade. Gray, for the slope of the ground underneath a handicapped parking space. It's always a killer.
We'll try not to put it on a hill.
To try to make it happen. Town Hall doesn't have it, but Town Hall was an existing building. Any other items noticed by people? Yes,
Claire, are you talking dimension from the end of the existing building to the end of the proposed addition in terms of the 100?
Well, I think that's something that, that's what I was looking at. It kind of looks like a footprint.
But so I think in the building's described as being 80 by 44, is that correct? The new addition? Yeah, okay. And I guess a question to the planner, does the 100-foot maximum distance, that's without an offset, though, isn't it? And there's an offset within that distance.
Yeah, that's an unbroken face.
Yeah, okay.
Unbroken face.
Yeah.
Okay. And we could look at that at the larger size and see how the faces relate.
Well, might as well just address the question, and the applicant is free to come back with anything they want. Town Center District describes certain improvements that happened between the front of the building and the street line or the sidewalk. And I think there were sketches in there about special signage, and I noticed the signage on the building, but I don't know if there's something in here about lighting, which I think is primarily parking lot lighting, but anything, I saw the ground cover and some additional landscaping, but if there's anything that you have in mind in terms of special signage or something that kind of goes along with that character that's described in the town center ordinance. You may not feel that it's necessary, but if there's something in there, benches or whatever, that would be part of this project, I think you should make note of that on the plans.
Do any board members feel the need to do a site walk of the property at this point in time, ice covered as it may be?
I don't know that we need to do a formal site walk, but I think it would be helpful if the applicant had the corner of the building staked out, and perhaps a couple of stakes at the edge of the parking lot along the high school drive.
Or the boundary itself between the...
Are the property corners marked? Is there a pin or a monument?
There's a pin.
It's probably kind of deep in the ice right now.
There's a whole kind of property line as the property itself.
Yeah. In that case, I guess a stake at the corner of the building would be the easiest thing to do. One more. I promise this will be the last question. Have you discussed with Bill the issue of handicap, either the requirement for handicapped accessibility? For example, it's not clear to me how one gets from an accessible parking space into the donut shop that's located on the off the porch on the first floor. Oh, I guess it's really the second floor.
Yes, we have parking.
The way we've designed the building now is that the two main tenants we talked about both have downstairs and second floor aspects to them. So that both the, that's why the main parking is in the back, the main entrances to both these businesses would be from the parking in the back at grade. We did also want to provide on-grade access to the front, to the top upper floor, and so the sidewalk system here goes to the entrance there, which is at the second level. There's no handicap access to the several apartments on the top floor.
Do you know if whether or not that's a requirement?
I don't. It's not a requirement that I know of right now. The floor is less than 3,000 square feet.
In looking at the continuing on the accessibility question. In looking at the plans, I don't see, we don't have a rear elevation to the building. I don't see anything that really indicates fire escapes or anything like that from the, what would be the third story apartments from the back of the building. Is all of the emergency circulation requirement or the?
Interior to the building.
It's all interior, okay. The only issue I have with the health club is it might be competing against the sauna that we have here at Town Hall, so you might
be careful. Yeah, I was hoping it's late.
Yeah.
How do board members feel about a public hearing? Will you be back next month?
Oh, sure.
Would board members like to have a public hearing for a town center? This would be a different type of public hearing. I don't think we've had one of these yet in this new zone.
Oh, no, we didn't, did we?
A public hearing.
Mm.
To see what?
Let's have one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Steve?
I'd like to make a motion.
Thank you.
Motion for the board to consider, be it further ordered, that the application be tabled to the regular February 16, 1999 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor indicate by raising your right hands. Motion is approved. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
No, you're taking off the straights.
The last item on our agenda this evening is the election of officers. In January of every year, the board elects a chair and a vice chair to serve for the calendar year. And for the year of 1999, do any board members have any fellow board members to consider for nomination? Yes, Steve.
I'd like to nominate Peter Carter as chair.
Okay, have a second. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, indicate by raising your right hand. It's unanimous. Peter?
It was Alice, wasn't it? Wasn't it Alice?
I know your name, but I didn't hear what you said.
Well, you're doing better than I am, Alice.
Congratulations, Peter.
Thank you, Mark.
I'm sure you'll do a very able job. We, however, Peter may not be able to make it to every single meeting or may have a conflict of interest, and therefore we will need a vice chair. Are there any members who have any suggestions for vice chair?
I'd like to nominate Mr. McNichol.
Okay.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, indicate by raising your right hand. And we have a unanimous vote on that also. Thank you very much.
And Mr. Chairman, we'd like to thank you very much for your year of work as chairman. You've done a splendid job.
Well, thank you.
I'll second that.
I'll second that.
I'll do whatever I can
third
back up in the future.
I'd like to reflect that as Mr. Wilcox's vice chair, I only had to serve once in an entire year.
I didn't even know you were. I'm sorry, I didn't congratulate you.
Well, it's been a pleasure.
Do we act on the appointments at the workshop meeting? Is that when that happens? For the committees?
On what?
The committee appointments that are in the...
Yes, I believe we have another couple of weeks.
Actually, there was a committee that was being set up that we needed to have a member of the planning board.
Community services.
Be considering that.
We could do that at workshop.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah, we can do that at workshop.
Yeah.
I'd like to make another motion.
Yes.
To adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? Right hand. Thank you very much. Meeting is adjourned.